Hi. So it looks like we have about 60 participants. So I think that's a good number to begin, and other folks will be joining us as we go along. My name's John Hatfield, and I'm the Executive Director of Socrates. And I want to welcome you all to the 2021 Socrates Annual Info Session. So I assume you're all tuning in to find out about the program and some specifics about how this all works and your applications and things like that. But I thought that I would start off with just a little bit of overview of Socrates, who we are, what we do. We're about 34 years old now. So we've been doing this for quite some time. And Socrates is a nonprofit that has a license agreement with the New York City Department of Parks and Recreation to maintain, program, and operate public land. So we are officially a New York City public park. So we're within their jurisdiction and domain, but we pretty much do everything that you see in and around the park. Think of ourselves, and we've had many discussions about the mission of the organization, but really we do three things all at once. But the primary thing that Socrates does is commission and present contemporary public artworks and projects. That is our primary function of who we are. It goes all the way back from its genesis with an artist named Mark de Souvereau, who founded the park and continues throughout the 34 years history. We've always been doing this by presenting, commissioning work, and even fabricating on site. You'll hear a little bit more about that. So we're a visual arts organization primarily. However, throughout the entire time of Socrates' existence, we've been very involved and embedded in the community itself. The process of reclamation at the park really is part of the DNA of how we are embedded in the community, in that Mark de Souvereau took it upon himself to initiate the process of reclaiming this derelict piece of land. And his initial vision was simply to create public space and present artworks. And that vision of reclamation was quickly absorbed and supported by the community. And they joined in as well through either volunteering or in other ways to drag out the old cars and make this a usable space. The origin stories of Socrates is a very, very unique example of what now urban planners call creative placemaking. It's a strategy by which arts and culture reinvigorate and activate places that have been abandoned or no longer in use. So this happens, not only this happened here in Queens, this is a topic and subject of work being done throughout the country, particularly in post-industrial areas close by waterfront. So Socrates is kind of a unique organization in its early days of forging this public-private partnership with the city to provide arts and culture and green space to underserved community. So first and primarily visual arts organization commissioning public artworks. We also have an extensive and in-depth social programming here at the park, and that consists of any number of things. So social programming is kind of a broad arm around all the activities and programs that we run, but it includes things like four different and distinct educational programs. It includes large-scale community day events. It also includes performances, the Met Opera comes, jazz series, other kinds of musical performances, and then other things that are more related to the land, which are healthy living, activities like free yoga and kayaking. Socrates doesn't do all of these all by herself. We're very tiny. We have a small staff, but we're able to have an enormous impact and footprint because we also partner with about 50 other nonprofit partners to achieve this sort of programming scope. So some of our partners are people we've worked with for almost decades, and some change every year. And they run the gamut from curatorial partners, colleagues in our field of public art, to social service agencies that are working with underserved youth, to the local public high schools and middle schools. All of these are our partners that kind of we all join forces in producing the program. And lastly, the third other component, and I don't mean to put them in such hierarchical ways, because that's not exactly how it operates. It operates as kind of an entire ecosystem. But obviously the ecosystem has a lot to do with the fact that we are a place. It's a 5-acre park, and Socrates does all of the horticulture and management and operation of the park. So that's certainly another component of what we do. And we're the caretakers of the land. And we often are doing projects to improve it incrementally as the years go by. So you may see some images maybe of the history of the park where it's a rather bleak landscape. And today it's a rather thriving green space thanks to, you know, the work that preceded us, but also the work that we're doing currently on just improving the conditions and you know, the landscape, the plantings and everything. So these three things, you know, comprise the entire ecosystem of Socrates. The part that you're all interested in and you're tuning in for is a program that we developed quite a while ago, where we support and commission emerging artists to produce work. We felt that it's important that given, you know, the context particularly of New York City, the opportunities to produce outdoor work is very, very, very few. So we have a role to play, I think an important role to play in the cultural life of the city and with artists in particular in providing that opportunity. And our hopes and dreams are obviously that you create something that's extraordinarily fulfilling and manifests your visions. And we also hope that we're building careers and that it's not a program where, you know, it's sort of one and done. We try to maintain relationships with our alumni, and we try to continue those relationships over the years. So oftentimes having this under an artist's belt in terms of experience with public art can lead to other opportunities to do the same with other organizations and venues. So that's also an overarching goal of ours, is to support an artist generally in their entire career. I guess I would recommend, if you haven't, two things. One is to visit our website. We have a very robust website that enumerates and goes into all of our different kinds of programming. The social programming that I described is all represented on the website. But maybe more importantly for you, the entire history of the park and almost every single project ever produced is in an archive and searchable. And that's always interesting for artists to look through. It is about 1,300 projects. So you might want to, I would start at the beginning, dabble in that, go into the middle, dabble in that, and then certainly look at the most recent past few years. So that's your digital kind of homework that I think will help inform your proposals and also just help inform you about what Socrates is about. But I'd also visit. It's really important if you can come physically to the park. We're open every single day. All of our programs are free. We are a New York City public park. So, and by coming, you'll be able to see, depending upon what time of day and the weather, you know, what kind of people come to the park, how the land is used. And in particular, you'll be able to see our current exhibition, which is Monuments Now. And we just completed all phases of that exhibition. Most recently, the 10 emerging artists have installed their versions of monuments. So you can kind of get a sense of scale and scope of their projects and just get a feel for the park. So the evening's gonna kind of go basically, you know, an overview of the park a little bit. Jess Wilcox, I'll introduce you to. She is the curator and director of exhibitions. And she'll talk, I think, a little bit about the process of the application and the kind of curatorial vision and curatorial criteria with which we look and lens and what we might expect to see in a proposal. And then we'll answer questions as we go along. So unfortunately, I don't get to see you all in this webinar format, but please, you know, make use of the chat and make use of the Q&A buttons, and we'll try and answer all your questions. So I think with that, I'll hand it over to Jess.
Thank you, John, for that introduction. And I'm just happy at the numbers of people who are interested, and just reiterate that John gives good advice in terms of what makes a strong application. I think those are the top two things: looking at past works that have been exhibited in the park and visiting the site. And often reviewing applications, you can kind of tell who did those things and who didn't. So it will be to your benefit. I'm just gonna start a screen share. And share a PowerPoint. Can you guys see the PowerPoint? Okay. This is just, I think, helpful for people, again, to see images of the park, get a feel for how we work here. This is an image during installation of an artwork by Joe Riley and Audrey Snyder, I think 2 years ago. You see the artists and myself are there with one of our installation crew. And I think it just gives you an idea of, you know, how hands-on a process this is, working with large scale sculpture in a DIY fashion sometimes means putting the work on casters and reeling it out to look at locations. So I just thought this is a nice image to start on. But of course, you know, first things first, which is just the hard data, a reminder that the submission deadline is Friday, December 4th, 2020, at essentially midnight. That's run by submittable. So if you do not finish on time, the program, it's a software program, automatically kind of bounces back and rejects your application. So I would suggest starting it ahead of time. Notification is the end of March. We used to put March and then people would call at the beginning of March and say, wait, what's going on? Between that time, we go through the applications, and we actually have curatorial advisors who help us select finalists. This every year it's different colleagues and curators. This year it's Emma Enderby, who is the senior curator at The Shed in New York. And Lauren Zelaya, who's the director of public programs at the Brooklyn Museum, also in New York. Each year, myself and John are also on the curatorial selection committee, but each year we like to bring in new perspectives and, you know, new bodies of knowledge in making those selections. Between December and March, that's what we're doing, is reviewing the selections. And then we have semi-finalists who are contacted for interviews, just diving a little deeper into the projects. We have a kind of lengthy application, but of course, public artwork is a notoriously difficult and challenging genre of artwork to produce. So those interviews help clarify questions. Sometimes, we ask in our application about process, materials, and proposals, but sometimes there's things that aren't quite clear about process that we ask about. And usually those questions tend to be about the process and the work. It's, once you're a semi-finalist, it's a lot about, a little bit about pragmatics rather than, your practice in general. We are selecting a proposal, not necessarily just an artist to work with. In constructing your proposal, that's the kind of key. Of course, in our application, we ask for images of past works, and that is, a very important part of the proposal, because it allows us, to see maybe materials that you've worked with before. If you're proposing to make the work cast concrete, it can be good to show in your past work some images or some examples if you've worked in that media before. Likewise, if it's a collaboration, if it's participatory, you might want to, it would be a stronger proposal to show examples of that kind of work. That's kind of the application process, and you're notified at the end of March. The fellowship is May through September. First we have kind of some administrative onboarding, a kind of introductory meeting. We have a studio orientation, but then the bulk of the fellowship, when you're allowed to have access to the studio, which is an outdoor studio, I'll get to that later, is May through September. And the exhibition is fall 21, we don't have the exact date yet, through spring 2022, similar to this year. These are just some images that will kind of remind you of the introductory story that John talked about, that this was a former landfill. I also like to point that out because it sometimes provides some challenges in installation in terms of drainage and, the fact that this was kind of DIY rehabilitated, we don't always know exactly what's underneath our soil. Here's a historical image of the cleanup, with local community members. And then of course, this is sort of what it looks like today, just to give you an idea of that narrative that a lot of artists have found inspiring the narrative of the park in making work here. So I just show those images. I think an important thing to remember in creating your proposal, again, is location. So here's the Google satellite image of Socrates Sculpture Park. I don't think you can see my cursor, but on the right, you have Vernon Boulevard, which is one kind of triangular side of the park. Another, if you think of the park as like a triangle, another side down below to the left is you see the Costco parking lot. There is Costco right there. And then not, I don't think I, no, I don't have another map, but you know, the third part of the triangle, of course, is the East River. But it's also worth mentioning that to the north is a NYSHA housing, Astoria houses. To the south is Queensbridge houses, and also Queensbridge Park. And so we also have neighboring parks, which is interesting, which, you know, are quite different in that, you know, they're not sculpture parks. But I think it's, you know, important to consider this kind of geography, or in geography. Across the river is Randall's Island. And then you can also see the Upper East Side and actually Gracie Mansion. This was not taken this year. We had, our crowds weren't so thick during COVID pandemic, but it just gives you an idea of what our crowds and audiences could be, also in terms of thinking about how people interact with your art or don't interact and maybe just bump into your artwork, and thoughts about durability. You know, in a normal year, we get 200,000 people. So yeah, I'm just gonna, wait, I'm having trouble. Sorry, there's a little animation that I'm having trouble forwarding now, hold on. Let's try this again. And I think it's also important to point out that, and thinking about artworks, that, you know, it's not just an arts audience, as John mentioned. We have healthy living, yoga classes, kayaking. Again, there's a view of the skyline. The mini farmers market, dance performances. So, you know, often we have a stage up, which takes up an area of the landscape, which is important to consider. And, you know, sometimes we have large events with thousands of people that need a place to sit for our cinema nights. And yeah, a great number of our audience are kids, again, to see how packed it is. We offer art making workshops, which, you know, often artists, fellows, show, and artists, current artists, fellows, and artists alumni sometimes make proposals to create workshops. That's kind of separate from the fellowship process, and you can work with our public programs director, Audrey DeMola, to sort of develop that. But these happen in Styx, our education studio, and Styx 2.0, which is the kind of indoor version where we, for inclement weather. So this is just some imagery of that. It's also worth mentioning that, you know, since John arrived at the park, there's been a push to do some even larger scale projects that than had previously occurred, and some solo artist exhibition projects. So this is an image of Agnes Dennis's Living Pyramid. And I just, you know, think that's worth mentioning. You know, this was up at the same time that some of the artist fellowship projects were up, and this was 2015. There was overlap, and I think that's a nice opportunity for some artists, you know, to be shown with a kind of art historical or high profile artists. And so, you know, those shows are typically over the summer when artists are actually working in the studio. Which is the summer, you know, essentially May through September. So we had a solo show for Neri Ward, Virginia Overton. So these works tend to be larger scale. But they also, that helps accommodate our larger crowds during the high season. Just back to some logistics. As I mentioned, those are the kinds of shows that are up over the summer while the fellowship's in session. And, you know, that part of the fellowship is park and studio access. And so you can access the studio area when the park's open, which is every day of the year, from 9 a.m. to sunset. So obviously, you know, sunset changes throughout the year. In the summer, you can, I think it's sometimes the sunset's at 9 p.m. So you can stay that late. It starts to set earlier, you know, 6:45 in September. So, you know, you can plan your days accordingly. Our office is right across the street from Socrates. That is the administrative offices. And this is what it looks like. It's kind of hidden. And our staff and office hours are 10 a.m. through 6 p.m. Monday through Friday. You know, I know artists, you know, you're free to work on the weekends and in the evenings while the sun's out late. You know, for meetings that need to occur with staff, we ask you to kind of work within our working hours. But, you know, we give you more access to work because I know some of you have day jobs as well that you need to make your artwork at other times. So this is part of the outdoor studio, which we call the shed. And it's just a note to, you know, see what it looks like and also remind people that it's an open air studio, so you're working in public. You know, we have like a little barrier that says staff only, but the public often will come up and ask what you're doing. You can also see in this picture, there's kind of like a little tent with, you know, with a tarp for draping. Some artists prefer more privacy and set something up like that themselves. There are areas in the studio that are kind of further back, not right along the path. But it is it's like sort of a reality but it is, I think it's also a benefit, you know, because some people really enjoy seeing certain park visitors day after day that can see the process of their work transforming. And, you know, I know that the public likes to see that transparency and sort of they appreciate the demystification of the production process. So, you know, we require artists to go through a studio orientation with our studio manager, you know, in May. And after they complete that, they are given keys to the shipping containers here, which have our tools. There's a few different ones. And, you know, that at that moment, you're welcome to sort of use the space. They all look kind of similar, but one of those shipping containers directly, if you walk all the way back and to the right, is our studio manager's studio. So he's kind of, we do have some staff that have offices in the park rather than the kind of administrative offices across the street. It's also worth noting that the studio space is shared. You know, we don't, tape off areas of, you know, 20 by 20 feet or whatever and say you work there. It tends to usually work out. People have different schedules, different ways of working. Some people are very slow and steady. Some people like to have short bursts of activity. Of course, during installation period, it gets a lot more crowded. But we've sort of always shared the space this way and never had, you know, terrible problems. So, but it's something to consider. You know, I mentioned the studio orientation. Safety is really important because it's a shared studio space, because it's in public. You know, we just ask you to be extra careful about safety. So as I mentioned, you know, artists work throughout the summer to create their projects. Depending on what the project is, you know, there's different ways of prepping before installation. This is an image of a kind of installation site by an artist, Liane Bosque. And this is an example of a work that the artist did a lot of work beforehand, but couldn't actually build it on site until installation. So the artwork, I wish I should have had a piece of the finished artwork. The artwork was a kind of brick footprint of a historic building, which is actually like a mile down the road from Socrates, and architectural a terracotta factory, or an old one. And so she created, you know, this brick structure, and she worked with the public at the park, creating mold tiles that actually had different imprints, architectural elements imprinted into the ceramic in relief. And so she did workshops with the public throughout the summer, and fired those and planned and prepped those. But it was not until the kind of 3 weeks of installation in the fall that she was able to sort of assemble those pieces together. You know, so that's one way of working. Other artists, I think the majority of the works are not done that way, but are actually built in components in the studio and then moved out. You know, planning and time management is really important, because that installation is 3 weeks long, or sometimes, depending on how many artists, 2 weeks long. And, you know, it's 15 artists in 3 weeks, or I think 10 artists in 2 weeks. So it's a tight turnaround. And, you know, so we give you help with installation. You know, we hire an install crew who's there not all the time, but just to help you. So the kinds of things that they do are helping with creating foundations, leveling the works, pouring concrete. But, you know, they were not helping. This is an image of a Sherwin Banfield piece in process. You know, they were not helping him create those busts at all. So, you know, in a work like this with Liane's, where it's built on site, it's a little blurrier of a line with installation. But, you know, Atzel, our studio manager, and our operations assistant are available to help when artists are on site. And, you know, the more time you spend in the outdoor studio, usually, you know, just because you're there often, the more help you'll get at that moment. So, you know, this is just a reminder again about installing and working in public. You'll see that we have caution tape around there for safety. And yeah, the public is wanting to interact with artists. We do have some larger scale equipment that we use on a case-by-case basis that is generously, donated by Space Time, which is Mark DeSouvreau's studio. They generously donate, his crew generously donates time to, use the equipment to help us install certain pieces. And we use that sparingly, only when we need to. We don't really bring out the lift just for fun. So again, there's also selective rigging assistance from Space Time. Here's an image of during installation. There's that that piece you saw before, and an example of our poor drainage in our lawn. So that's one thing that, you know, I ask artists to be flexible about and consider in relationship to locating their artworks in the terrain. A lot of times artists submit proposals and they say, I want my artwork right here, it's site specific. And we can't always do that, honestly. The studio manager and myself, know what kinds of works tend to work in which locations, areas where there is poor drainage. It's not currently mapped, but part of the reason is that the drainage changes with different exhibitions when different artworks are moved and taken away. Sometimes it creates new drainage channels. So it's kind of, it's a challenge. It can be a challenge to work with. And here's the completed artwork of the one you saw earlier, Sherwin Banfield piece. I just like to talk about what kind of proposals, I mean, you've seen some of them, but what kind of proposals we accept. And, Cypher in Queens is one of them, which actually was proposed as a monument before we did our monument show. But this work also, it has three Queens, iconic Queens hip hop artists, but also plays their music. I think you can tell there's speakers in there. So, you know, audio is okay. We have electricity on site that you can run a wire through to the electricity box, and we trench a wire. I like to show this one, Doreen Garner. This is glass and silicon, so materials that are maybe not so typical in a sculpture park, but she works in a lot of materials, but trained mainly in glass, and was really excited to be able to present glass work outside. And I think, glass isn't something people automatically think of with public art, but it was really quite powerful and quite beautiful with the light. Deborah Friedlander, an artist who worked with epoxy resin to create fluorescent sunshine. So again, this is just to show the diversity of projects. Madeline Hollander created a series of performances that roamed throughout the park. So we accept performance as well. Works like this that are also functional, Leah Satera's Design Within Reach, obviously a popular one among our visitors. Again, another work that has light. It doesn't look that, you could tell it was lit up, but maybe not so much in this picture. Yeah, so, you know, we're interested in a variety of medium and scale. I guess most of the works I just showed you are larger scale, but, you know, we also accept smaller scale works. Just a note, yes, I mentioned a little bit about project siting. So this is kind of how I go about doing it. You know, I, as the curator, make the ultimate decision of the location and consultant with the studio manager because of all those questions about what's underneath the ground, how deep of footings do we need for a certain kind of project. Usually I ask each artist to think about 2 to 3 locations that interest them. And then I kind of make a map like this where I move all these pieces around to create an installation that works for everyone and create, I think, nice juxtapositions between different works, because it is a group show and it's, you know, as you're working in the studio with your fellow artists, conversations happen and emerge. And it's nice to be able to work with that in the layout of the exhibition. So yeah, I guess finally, I would just come to this year's thematic, which is something that is sort of newer to the program. Began last year, last year we announced the call for an open call for monuments, and those monuments that the Artist Fellows created are currently on view. You know, I think it received compliments from the artists who participated, and some mention of jealousy from past alumni artists in the opportunity to respond to a curatorial prompt. So we decided to try that again this year. And I think, you know, these kind of questions are open-ended enough for artists to take them in a variety of different directions. But I think in a time living with COVID-19, this idea of sanctuary is quite powerful. So the idea of, yes, the term sanctuary is the theme of this year's open call. And I mean, it's right here. I can read it aloud. I guess I'll skip the first part. And just say the word sanctuary derives from the Latin sanctus and holy. And actually, I can't read my screen because it's being blocked. Okay. Here, I'll have to do this. And signifies a sacred or holy place. The word's secular meanings are now more frequently employed, such as the broader place of refuge or safety, or the more specific nature reserve. In medieval times, political fugitives and debtors sought sanctuary at the church as a place of immunity and asylum. And the word today retains some of the connotation of spirituality from this early connection to religion. Sanctuary is not just a place of shelter and protection, but also a place of reverence imbued with the energy of social generosity. We welcome artists to consider all forms of sanctuary. Spaces of rest and pause, offering a haven from the spread, from the speed and demands of urban life. Communities where immigrants, undocumented and documented, are protected from persecution. Places of meditation and rumination on the social, political, and ethical challenges of contemporary society. And environments for non-human lives, plant, animal, bacteria, fungus, in a world that is not entirely distinct and separate from humans, but always in relationship to them. And I ask, what does sanctuary mean to you? And most crucially, how can art function as a sanctuary, a place of refuge, rest, and meditation without resorting to escapism? During the current economic, social, environmental, and public health crises, how can public art provide a sanctuary and aid the process of healing? So, that is, I hope, a thought-provoking prompt for artists to consider. And then with that, I'll just, you know, sort of reiterate some of the selection criteria. You know, we ask for past images and of course ask about your practice in general, but, you know, we are evaluating the specific proposal, not just the artist. So that's the practicality is highly important, you know, that it is buildable within the budget. Part of the application process asks for a budget. So if we see something, you know, we've seen other budgets before. If we see something that doesn't feel realistic within the budget, it probably will not be selected. Durable for outdoor environment. You know, in the proposal, when we ask about project process, you know, we expect it to last. You know, we have a artwork right now that is actually a wax flag that burns, so it's supposed to sort of change and degrade over time. So, but you know, the artist did a lot of research on melting points of wax and. You know, it melting while being burned was part of the conception of the piece, but all of his research on the different sort of melting points of wax was also made a very strong proposal that he was considering, you know, the work and all the elements. Safe for public interaction, of course. You know, and as for artworks that have a participatory element, some explanation of how the artist expects those to work, I think is quite crucial. And then lastly, that it somehow addresses this prompt, you know, in which I think is fairly wide open. And yeah, this is just a group of our current fellows who sort of just presented their work to, you know, just remind you that, you know, there's also an element of socialness and community that's built throughout the fellowship time. Yeah, and here's the application, a link to the application, which you can find on the website. So yeah, I think that's kind of the end of my spiel. And then maybe John can join me again and we can look through some of these questions that we've received.
Yeah, I've been typing away.
Oh, okay.
Answering questions as things have gone along. And a couple of them are multiple questions kind of about the same thing. So I'll try and address a few of them now. But it's just easier verbally. Many people have asked about the New York City aspect of the program. We do receive funding and we do support artists who are located in New York City or in its environment. However, we have also in the past selected artists who whose primary residence is not in the city, but who may be in the city. One of the issues that we have is that the program does not include any housing, it does not include any indoor studio space. It is purely for the opportunity of making the work and presenting it at the park. So it's not exclusive to New York City residents, but a lot of time because of that sort of logistical parameter of like being here, it tends to be New York City residents. Some people have asked about slightly COVID related questions. we've navigated the year with being able to produce all of the work that we had committed to in terms of the artists. We have not been able to, and we did have to cancel all programming that involves people congregating in groups. The park was deemed essential. The park was open throughout the entire pandemic and continues to be open. As far as working on site, we require that people follow the protocols of what's safe in terms of wearing masks and wearing protective equipment and not congregating closely. So that's the general way that we're proceeding. As for next year, we're not entirely sure about what our social programming may or may not be. It will be, hopefully better, but I would anticipate there would be things that we would not be able to do. So if your work is predicated on performance that congregates folks, there are ways of doing that, which we have done. We've done it virtually through recording and live broadcasting. But it's all dependent upon the situation at the time. And so someone would have to necessarily be flexible about how that might transpire, if it could transpire. I can't really answer it any more than that. Someone asked about outdoor cinema. We're not sure either whether we are going to continue that program. That is a particularly, we can have up to 3,000 people in the park in very close proximity. We're not sure if we are going to do that next year as a commitment. There's questions about assistance with instruction, with equipment, i.e. welding, assistance with sourcing materials and also welding. Generally, artists are responsible for the production and fabrication of their work. We do provide assistance and on welding certain aspects and teaching someone how to weld. Sourcing materials, we can help advise in that regard, but you should be coming with your project with sources of where you may get that materials. We will always chime in. We'll always be checking in all along the way in the design and fabrication of your work and what's needed. For example, weld the entire piece for you as production. That would have to either have someone, or we'd have to make arrangements for someone who's skilled to do that entire. We can certainly help a little bit. Someone asked about a lot of other questions about electricity. We have had many projects that require electricity. If it's a constant source of electricity, we trench from the source. That means we have to dig a trench from across the park to the location of where the electricity is needed. So we have done that. It's not too laborious because we do have a bobcat that can kind of dig that trench, but laying that, it's a little bit complicated, but we do it quite often. So we don't use generators. Someone asked about use of a generator throughout the exhibition. That's not something we would do. we would trench, it would have to be trenched and sort of plugged in. Trying to think if there's any other questions, but maybe we can look on the question status.
Yeah, I see someone said if not located in New York City, but would have access to housing, should we specify this in the application? I would feel free to. We do not and cannot provide housing for artists outside of the city. So yes, I mean that's a kind of relief of your proposal. When working with artists outside this city, and if they get to the semi-finalist stage in the interview phase, that's a thing that we reiterate with them to confirm that they have housing, since that is not something we provide. So yes, that would be helpful in the fellowship application, because then we wouldn't have to ask that question. Would a current student graduating in May 2021 be considered? And I would say yes. If you were graduating in May 2021, you would be considered graduating for the fellowship time. Do you have more? Okay.
There's one that's, can you provide any high-res images of the park in an emptyish state for us to use in our renderings? Interesting thing about Socrates is we're very busy all the time. So there's almost never an opportunity to actually photograph the park when there's not something on view. We can provide it depends upon your site. I personally would suggest that you just come and photograph. If you happen to be in New York, I would come and photograph the areas and use your own photography. But there will be there's almost always other works on view. So it is difficult to do Photoshop renderings.
I see a question. Can the budget be used to pay assistance? Absolutely, yes. I would say probably a third, maybe to a half. It depends on the year. Of the fellows use some of their project budget, not their honorarium, but their project budget, to pay for assistance. Sometimes it's more on the production aspect. Sometimes it's for all kinds of different things. We just ask, we don't want people's assistants working alone in the studio without the artist. But yes, assistants are highly encouraged. The question, if I were to propose an installation that specifically was an area that flooded, would electricity be problematic? Does the park handle all the electrical engineering? So that kind of comes back to the discussion about locations and the fact that ultimately it's the curator and studio manager decisions. We would not install a piece with electricity in a place that we think is prone to flooding in order to avoid that situation, I guess, is what I would say. There's a lot of questions.
Housing we answered. Offer some advice for artists writing their Socrates proposal for their first outdoor sculpture of any scale. I would just be specific about what it is you want and hope to accomplish and how you might go about achieving that. That's as good of advice as I can offer. We have selected projects based on entirely textual descriptions. We've accepted projects that are exceptionally detailed in their renderings and specificity. A lot of times previous work helps inform us on some of the capabilities of an artist. If an artist has produced work, even though it's not outdoors, but has produced work of certain sophistication or a certain complexity physically, certainly informs us and tells us that they're probably capable of translating that to an outdoor environment.
There's something that said, you said concrete foundation must be included in the proposal budget. How do we estimate this? Can you tell us how much that costs SP per square foot? I think maybe there's some confusion. Some of the artworks that we showed are, you know, performance, and depending on the work, not every artwork does need a concrete foundation. It depends on like the footprint of the work. So that's a conversation with a studio manager. You can look up, if you go onto Home Depot and look up concrete per square inch, you can make a cost estimate. Concrete is not extremely expensive, so I would not lose sleep over that or spend much time on that.
Without knowing the specifics of the, in other words, we do footings if something structurally is required, and that footing could be 12 inches in diameter and 24 inches in the ground. Some foundations, however, if it's supposed to hold something of dramatic weight, you know, we've poured foundations of enormous scale.
Yeah.
So by per square foot, that it would depend upon what your proposal, you know, what you're using that foundation for, or if it's necessary.
This is a good question, and one that I'm curious what you think of, John. Is a student on leave, can a student on leave from their program, I'm assuming, be considered?
If you're on leave during the time of
the fellowship, yeah.
Of the fellowship, yes.
Yeah, that's what I would think. Okay. Are there areas of the park that don't flood at all? As I said, it changes over time. So, I don't think one can make their proposal based on like assumptions of, I'm going to do this in a space where it will never flood.
So I think we should parse the word flood.
Yeah.
So the park doesn't flood from the river.
No.
During Sandy, the park was entirely covered in water from flooding from the river. But the park itself does not flood periodically. The water does not crest over and flood into the park. I mean, that would be a highly unusual circumstance. What we're referring to is an accumulation of water puddling that occurs because there is no substantial drainage and this is landfill. So there are areas of the park that retain water a little longer after heavy, heavy rains. And those would dissipate after a little bit of time. And we know where those areas are, and Jess is very mindful, as well as our studio manager, of like locating work if it's sitting in water for a little while would be problematic, but it doesn't, there's no flooding from the river.
Did we talk about this one? Someone asked, what is your definition of emerging artist? Can you guys address that verbally? I don't like the term emerging artist and don't use it. I feel like this group can be self-selecting. We have no age limit. to that. Within our application, we do have an opportunity for specific funding to be assigned to certain artists who are under 30, but that is not a requirement to apply to the program. And we definitely take artists with many, many more years than 30. And, you know, your definition of, you know, if you want to apply to this fellowship, we will look at your application. We're not going to say you've had too many shows or this or that. You know, the criteria is that you want to participate in terms of, yeah, who this is for. So that is that. John, do you want to say, is it permissible for artists to propose a budget that includes additional external support or other grants?
That's a very good question. We haven't historically done that. We really would not, if it's we don't select projects that is contingent upon receiving other funding that hasn't already been secured or that we definitely do not do. So, and we tend and we do appreciate and like the idea that artists are coming somewhat with a project or something that is within the parameters of what Socrates is funding. If there's a very specific case of something in particular, I guess I would describe that in your application. Generally though, we like to support and have the artist supported through the program.
Yeah, and if it's something that is not scalable and is entirely dependent on, you know, a great deal of other funding that is not secured, it would not be a strong proposal. I saw something. Oh, are we required to submit in our portfolio a rendering of the project proposal? Not specifically a rendering, a computer rendering, but we do ask for images. So some people draw and sketch them out. Some people, you know, collage them. Some people do computer renderings. So some kind of imagery of what the work you hope it will look like. Yes. But it doesn't have to be like an architectural rendering. I think most of these we've answered. Stronger proposals, the ones that contain rendering question marks. I mean, the more thorough, yes, but I don't necessarily prefer architectural renderings. But, you know, the more thorough and comprehensive a proposal, the stronger it is. I think we're kind of slowing down with the questions. So yeah, I think it was typed in the chat that if you have additional questions, they can be sent to curatorial at SocratesSculptureParc.org. Maybe someone from the team can share that email one last time. Oh, yes. This recording will be posted online. I'm looking forward to reading all these proposals. All right, thanks.
Thank you all for joining us. And we are so appreciative of your interest. And yeah, as Jess said, we look forward to seeing what you propose for us.
All right.
Have a lovely evening.